I thought I'd give you guys an update on the Studebaker because many of you have been asking what's going on with that thing, why haven't we seen it? So I thought it was definitely time for an update. Basically what happened was in the last videos I did months ago, I had just carb swapped the thing. So I'd, you know, put a new intake carb, full new fuel system on it, and I had the thing running perfectly. And then of course, as soon as it was running perfectly, the transmission decides to quit working on me. So I just kind of parked it. And obviously Jordan had the garage taken up with some of the other projects we had going on. I just kind of let it sit to the side for a bit. But now I really feel like I need to get on it because it's that time of year where we're having car cruises and I want to be able to take it out and drive it around. One good coincidence is that Jordan just pulled the engine out of his 87 Trans Am here. And behind that is a really fully built 700 R4 with a nice higher stall torque converter and everything. What I'm going to do is actually rob that out of here with Jordan's permission, obviously, and put it in the Studebaker. And the reason I can do that is because Jordan wants to do a completely different drivetrain in here. I don't think he's settled on what he's doing yet, but he's thinking a 6-speed manual for sure. But I don't know if he's going old school small block again or if he's going LS. So we'll have to wait and see what he's going to do there. I'm going to go ahead and get this thing lifted up and we'll see how it goes. Right, that's sitting pretty good, and hopefully that'll give me enough room to get to everything. If not, I'll have to raise the back up too. I'm just trying to avoid anything I can, just make it a little quicker. I didn't realize he still had the full freaking exhaust under here, so I need to get that out of the way first before I can do anything else. Alright, I ended up putting it on four ramps just to get it up plenty high, since I have to get under there and get the exhaust out and the torque arm. It'll just make life easier. Took a little more time to get it up, but it'll help. Still looks pretty good. Basically, to get this out of here, I need to get the shifter cable off, get the torque arm off, get it loose from the drive shaft, and then you have the cross member there. I wouldn't even have to take the cross member out, obviously. I can just yank the transmission out the front once I get everything unhooked. But I definitely got to get the torque arm off of there first, then we'll go from there. I think for the purposes of what I'm doing here tonight, I'm going to start by just taking the top two bolts off of this mount here, and that way I can slide this torque arm out of there, and then I can take the bracket off after I get the transmission loose. Just the quickest way to do it, and I'm trying to avoid climbing back there and undoing the back of the torque arm, so I'm gonna try to skip that for now. Alright, I saved you a lot of the gory details, but Jordan did have to come out and help a bit because it was a mess. But I tried doing it the easy way, which definitely was harder than how we normally do it. But anyway, the transmission is out and sitting next to the Studebaker now. And you can see it had that nice FTI torque converter in there with you know, the anti-ballooning and everything. So that's definitely more than enough for the Studebaker. Matter of fact, I could you know, probably put a 125 or 150 shot of nitrous on that thing and it would still be okay, obviously. But it feels good to have it out. Trans Am's back on the ground, but we're gonna roll it outside, clean up the shop, and then we'll get started on this one.
Trying to clean up the floor so we're not slipping and falling all over the place. We used kitty litter to get this over here and it actually soaked it up pretty well. So let's hope that this transmission removal goes smoother than the one last night, because we're gonna be wasting a lot of towels.
Thank you.
All right, we got it on four ramps, just like we did the Trans Am. So we can get under there and see what we're working with here. Often we just pull the engine and tranny together. That wouldn't have been easy in this case either, just because of a particular setup. We really wanted to drop that tranny straight down because it's got this low car shifter setup. It's got all the linkage on it and everything. It was just the easiest way to get it out. Sorry about the lighting, but as you can see, we have the Trans Am transmission on the transmission jack there and under the Studebaker here. All we gotta do is twist the torque converter in there, and then we'll be able to raise it up in there and start putting it in. Okay, as usual, the sun is coming up and we're just finishing up for tonight, but we have the crossmember back in it. Jordan welded that back in there. Okay, drive shaft is in and U-joints greased, everything. So we should be good to go there. Jordan welded the crossmember back in here. It was just the best way to deal with it for the time being. We may end up replacing that later, but it'll work for right now. It's the next night, and I'm back out here in the shop again. Got quite a bit done last night. I was pretty pleased with how that went, other than, you know, it was a bit of a struggle here and there, but that's just how it goes sometimes. Over here, you can see the old exhaust that we pulled out from under the car. That was a pretty pathetic exhaust system. There's no crossover. It necks down to 2 inches here, which is definitely not enough. So Jordan's actually going to tackle making me a new exhaust system for the car. We've got enough laying around here that we can make up something decent. We may even put that homemade X-pipe in there. That's 2.5, and then we'll run probably 2.5-inch pipe throughout. And then I believe that's what the mufflers are on the end there, so we can probably reuse those. But that'll definitely free up a bit of power for sure. Between that, we actually have the drive shaft. That's one of the things I've got on the list tonight, is to get the drive shaft back in there, obviously. In fact, I made my little handy dandy cardboard list here. So I'm gonna tackle the drive shaft first, then I have to put the torque converter bolts in, starter back in, put the fill tube back in the trans, add fluid, shifter, and then deal with the exhaust last. The mini starter is back in as well, and now we're starting on the exhaust. Okay, so drive shaft done, torque converter bolts are all in, starter's in. You gotta put the fill tube in back for the transmission, and put some fluid in. The TV cable for the transmission is also hooked up. That's it right here. I got this really nice low car bracket for the throttle cable and the TV cable. We've messed with some cheaper brackets in the past and had some issues, so I bought a pretty decent bracket for this one. All right, guys, we're obviously adding the fluid to the transmission. The exhaust is done. The only thing left to do is the shifter, because I don't really want to use the old low car shifter, so I'll have to get something different. But for now, the plan is to at least fire the car up again so we can hear what the new exhaust sounds like. And then, but there's no way to really test the transmission until we get a shifter hooked up to it.
Oh, the choke's open too.
Yeah.
That's why it's gonna need a little extra fuel. We're gonna try a second start here. Smoke, but it's got that funky gas and car cleaner and everything else in there, so we'll put fresh gas in it and then we'll give it another shot a little later today. Pretty happy with it though. At least everything went back together, it's running again, and now we got that built transmission in there with a high stall converter. The only thing left we have to do is the 9-inch in here has got a set of either they're like 273s or 3-to-1 gears, I can't remember, but we're going to a set of 389s, is that what it is?
Yeah,
something like that. And so much lower gears. That with the stall converter is going to really make this thing pick up some speed, I'm sure. And it actually was geared too tall anyway because it's got overdrive. It's geared to like 200 miles an hour, you know.
Yeah.
So the low gears are going to make it better everywhere, I think.
You won't want that tall gear with the big stall anyway.
Yeah, not a good combo. But anyway, the only thing we have left to do is throw the shifter in it, and then we're going to take it for a drive, obviously, and see what it'll do. So pretty excited about it. Just got to get a shifter here as quick as I can because I don't want to put the low car shifter back in it.
In between that, we probably will loosen one of the AN fittings up front and get all of that gas out of it because it is clearly bad. It's smoking like this came out of a field.
Yeah, so we'll grab one of these old jugs and just pump it into it. How's this for service? I went to buy some groceries, came back, and Jordan's got my shifter all fixed up here. We still have to run the cable, but he's actually got it mounted and even made a custom shifter handle for it, so pretty cool. Check it out here.
But as you can see, we decided to go with a B&M Pro Gate shifter. Called that because it's a fully gated shifter, if you can see that. I've just kind of grown tired of the ratchet shifters, and I don't like shifters where like the Outlaw and Jordan GTO where you have to squeeze the trigger on the handle to get to third, that kind of thing. I just really like the ease of use of the gated shifters, and you really can't mess up. You can only go one gear at a time because of the design here.
If you're bashing it forward, it can't skip.
Right.
Because there's detents.
But as you can see, Jordan had to make a custom shifter for me because it came with a little short one and it was too far away in this particular application. And then this is a bench seat car, so that makes it another little thing you have to deal with. If it was buckets, it wouldn't be a big deal. We would have just put a raised platform for the shifter. But anyway, he made a custom shift lever here that comes right across the seat, second, third, you know, pretty cool.
I think the plan now is to go ahead and get the car back up in the air on ramps. That way we can crawl under it after it's up in the air. I think probably the best place to put the hole to get the cable through is going to be near the tail shaft where it starts to taper, because there'll be room. Your tunnel's really wide. We can probably punch a little hole through the side over there, but there's still nothing turning there. It's just, solid. And then we'll snake it through and run it up along the side of the pan. I think that's probably going to be where it fits the best. Hey, B&M, if you guys are watching this, because you guys actually have watched our videos in the past, like our mega shifter video, do a better job on these, okay? Look, I've bought lots of shifters from B&M, okay? I've had mega shifters, star shifters, the Pro Gate, you name it. I think I've used one other shifter, and it was a Hurst shifter in my GTO. So every other shifter for every other car that I've ever owned was a B&M shifter. However, the last two or three, I have had to chase the threads on this damn thing because it won't thread onto the end of the cable. And I don't know what's going on there with that. It's really annoying. So whoever you guys have doing these, tell them to do a better job, I guess, because it's really damn annoying whenever you're laying under the car and you go to thread it on, it will not start. And it's like literally, this is the third one of these third Pro Gate in a row that has had this problem. Mm-hmm. Like, this is brand new and it does not go on that cable. It'll go about two threads and then just stops. This is off of my Trans Am. This is probably 10 years old now, or 20, or oh god, no, actually that shifter was on it when I got it, so this has probably been on there since the 90s. Mm-hmm. And now I'm going to use it instead of this, which is brand new, because yet again it will not start on the end of the damn cable. And oh, you could damage the threads. No, it did not happen.
Well, we'll find out here in a second. If the old one goes on, then we know it's because the part was manufactured wrong.
Oh wow, weird. That one from 25 years ago fits perfectly. Odd.
It's almost like somebody that made the exhaust should have had the forethought to put the shifter on before finishing it and then fully welding it with no slip collars. Okay, I need the whatever magical size those are. Wrenches,
11/16 or something?
I can't remember. They also can have to be stubby.
Oh, yeah.
I'm gonna cut.
So, go cut a wrench in half?
Cut my wrenches in half.
Yeah, go cut this wrench in half. I'm gonna leave my damn wrenches alone. Go cut your Craftsman's or something. First of all, question, why am I filthy laying under your car that I've been working on all day? Where are you at with this? Why are you clean? You're not even sweaty. Look at it. Give me that camera. They deserve to know. You only haven't.
No. Nope. I spent $250,000 raising you. That's why.
Not a drop of sweat.
Your hands are clean.
What are you doing?
Being judgmental, mostly.
I thought you were looking for a wrench.
No, to cut in half so I can finish your car.
Oh, sure.
Let me move this exhaust pipe that I cut that was on one of my cars so that I could build your exhaust for you.
The exhaust that's in the way of the bolts?
I don't know what just came off of this.
Wow. Well, that was like $5, so that's not the best quality.
Oh, I guess there was a bolt star to it.
That was a... I had to round up so I could get free shipping. That's why I bought that.
Oh, crap. Not cut a German ratchet wrench in half so I can tighten your damn shifter cable. Hold it back together later because why is this up here? Do I want to ruin two?
Yeah, why not?
Cut two in half. Ooh, yep.
Yeah, touching it was really necessary.
Just making sure it's as hot
as... cuts metal every day. He's like, oh, it's hot.
I'm seeing how hot.
Exhaust right in the way was really smart. My finest motor.
Oh, do you want a light?
It doesn't matter. Oh, you mean something to see?
I mean, ultimately, none of it matters.
Yeah. I'll throw these wrenches in my... These are the special tools drawer, I guess.
Yeah, they're custom now.
Oh, they actually are working.
We've got the rear end up in the air, so we're going to start it up and just see if it engages in the gear and that sort of thing.
All right, guys, I've got the Studebaker cleaned up a bit here. Washed up the outside, vacuumed out the inside, and I haven't fully polished up the engine yet or anything, but I did kind of wipe it off a bit so it would look decent when I take it for a drive here. As you can tell, obviously, I don't have a hood on it yet. I'm still looking for a nice 53 or 54 Studebaker. It could be like a Starliner or a Commander hood, because this has a 53 front clip on it. This car is actually a 56 Sky Hawk, but it has a 53 front clip, 55 tail lights, and some other little custom mods, so it's a bit different than stock. But it still cleans up pretty decent. I'm getting ready to take it for a little drive here. One thing we're going to work on pretty soon is getting that deck lid to fit correctly. It's been wrong the entire time I've had it. There's also a little ding right here that we want to fix. But, you know, we'll get all that straightened out pretty soon. I did have to go get new plates because it sat off the road in the garage for so long they expired on me. Here, I'll go ahead and fire it up and we'll have a listen at the exhaust that Jordan put on it. Now, this is just temporary exhaust. We've got new exhaust coming on Wednesday. But this will give you an idea of what it's going to sound like. Previously, it had a pretty lousy exhaust system on it. Now, it's actually all 2.5-inch exhaust, then an X-pipe. Then it actually necks up into some 3-inch mufflers and then out through the tips. So it's much better than what it had. Should free up a little bit of power probably. Again, this is only temporary because currently it's hanging down a little low, so we had to buy some pieces to tuck it away better. Those will be here on Wednesday and then we'll get it all finished up. But I'll go ahead and rev it a couple times so you can get an idea what it sounds like. As you can tell, it's got a mild roller cam in it, so it's a very docile motor. It's very mild. Yeah, I think it sounds pretty decent, and it definitely is going to free up power because it was running through some 2-inch pipe in the middle section there, which is definitely not the best. Not that this is a really high horsepower motor or anything. It's only making, I don't know, 350, 360 horse. So it's but it's a fairly light car, so it still feels pretty peppy going down the road. I'm actually going to throw a couple cameras in there and take it for a little spin just to see how it runs out now.